This woman with the son that she was promised, the son passes away, and not once, but twice, she's able to muster up the strength in the midst of a chaotic situation and look and say, it is well. Then there's another group of people that just see it as just a lot of just chaos. I just can't wait till Christmas is over. I'm not hosting another guest. I'm not going to another potluck. And if I hear Mariah Carey sing that song one more time. And so this is King Herod. And now he's hearing there's another king in my town. And his insecurities rise up. There can't be two kings in this place. In this world, you will have trouble. But don't stop there. With the quick moment that I have, I want to put some things into perspective for you this morning. I want to read to you a scripture. Many would think I would come, obviously, out of a manger scripture, but I want to come to you real quick, and I want to read to you about a woman who was going through a moment of hardship, and she was going through an extremely difficult moment when she comes to a man of God, Elisha. You see, there's this woman, and she wants a child, and she's unable to have a child, and she's a righteous woman who had been hosting the man of God, the prophet Elisha. And the man of God comes and he tells her, you're going to have a son. And lo and behold, she has a son. And one day this son is out with his father and he starts complaining that he has this headache. And eventually gets back to his mother's home. And as his mother is standing over him, the child that was promised to her passes away. And I want to read to you this scripture where that takes off in 2 Kings chapter 4, verse 17 through 26. It says this, but the woman conceived and bore a son when the appointed time had come, of which Elisha had told her. And the child grew. Now it happened one day that he went out with his father to the reapers, and he said to his father, my head. So he said to a servant, carry him to his mother. And when he had taken him and brought him to his mother, he sat on her knees till noon and then died. And when she went up and laid him on the bed of the man of God shut the door upon him and went out. Then she called to her husband and said, please send me one of the young men and one of the donkeys that I may run to the man of God and come back. So he said, why are you going to him today? It's neither the new moon nor the Sabbath. And she said, it is well. And she said, it is well. Then she saddled a donkey and said to her servant, drive and go forward. Do not slacken the pace for me unless I tell you. And so she departed and went to a man of God at Mount Carmel. So it was when the man of God saw her afar off that he said to his servant Gehazi, look, the Shunammite woman. Please run now to meet her and say to her, is it well with you? Is it well with your husband? Is it well with the child? And she answered, it is well. If you keep reading, you'll see that she goes to Elisha and she says, you know, you promised me this child and he died and I don't know what's going on. And if you fast forward, the child is resurrected and comes back to life when Elisha goes and lays on him, he gets his life back. But I want to highlight what just took place. This woman with the son that she was promised, the son passes away, and not once, but twice, she's able to muster up the strength in the midst of a chaotic situation and look and say, it is well. You see, in this Christmas season, there's so many of us that, you know, there's two groups of people. A group of people that loves the potlucks, that love all the family gatherings, that love the workplace Christmas party. You love going to the mall and the hustle and the bustle. You love all the Christmas carols. You love all of that stuff. You love the commercials. You love all of it. You love hosting the guests out of town that stay longer than you thought they were going to stay. You love all of it. You love all of it. And then there's another group of people that just see it as just a lot of just chaos. I just can't wait till Christmas is over. I'm not hosting another guest. I'm not going to another potluck. And if I hear Mariah Carey sing that song one more time, I'm not going to be responsible for my actions. Two groups of people. And so for the other group of people that can't stand it, it's just a lot of energy and it's a lot going on and you just kind of want it to be over. And I've heard some call it Christmas chaos. Oh, I'm getting ready for the Christmas chaos. You know, the potlucks and the parties and all of that stuff. For those of you who can't stand all of that stuff, I just want to help, just for a quick moment, to help put things into perspective as it pertains to Christmas chaos. You see, if you've been with us for the past couple of weeks, we've been exploring all of the events that led up to and after the birth of Jesus. And so you know where I'm going. But the reality is you don't know Christmas chaos. Not like Joseph, not like Joseph. You see, as we discussed a few weeks ago, we have Joseph minding his own business with his betrothed wife, and she is a virgin. He had not been with her yet, and then she comes to him with the news that she is with child. With whose child? And so in this moment, there's a moment of, if you can imagine what Joseph is going through, you know, this is my betrothed wife. I had not yet lay with her, and she's coming to me, and she's telling me that she's with child. And so the scriptures tell us that there was a moment where Joseph thought to himself, I'm just going to divorce her quietly because I cannot bring this woman back with me to town because this was going to be considered a scandalous pregnancy. And so he thought about divorcing her. And then in the midst of that, the Lord speaks to Joseph and gives him the same confirmation that he gave to Mary. But for a moment, Joseph had his wife come to him that he had not yet lay with and say she was pregnant. That, my friends and family, is Christmas chaos. And if that wasn't enough, after the birth of the king, they hear word gets to King Herod, and King Herod finds that there is a born in my town the true king of the Jews. And so this is King Herod, and now he's hearing there's another king in my town, and his insecurities rise up. There can't be two kings in this place. And so out of fear and insecurity, he says, I need calls to the wise men. I need you to figure out where this boy is. Because there can't be two kings in the land. And when the Magi don't return, he sends out a decree and he says, okay, since I can't find this king, I'm going to kill every boy in the land 2 years and under. They mentioned it in the pageantry. That is, Pastor Kier's preaches and messages on it. That's the bloody side of Christmas that not a lot of people like to talk about, but it happened. Every person in the land with a boy 2 years and under, they were murdered. And there was wailing and weeping in the land. That is Christmas chaos. And the Magi, who were told after they left Herod, I want you to go and find out where he is. And they get word from the Lord, don't go back and tell Herod anything. Instead, you go about and you go and worship the Lord. And so they, what Herod would call us, they double-crossed him, but they were just being obedient to the Lord, didn't report back where the child was. And so now there was, I would imagine, a feeling of a murderous threat over the Magi's head as well. But they still were going and pressing through to find their way to that manger. I don't know all of what the Magi were feeling, but I could imagine in the midst of all this that was taking place, they were probably thinking, this is Christmas chaos. Christmas chaos. And what about that community? The community that didn't have their son. That community that had to lose their son in the midst of an insecure king. That is Christmas chaos. What I'm trying to do is kind of give you a reality check. This is Christmas chaos. Now, that's not to say that you haven't gone through some stuff. 2023 might have been an extremely difficult year. And maybe you're here today and you can legitimately say, no, Pastor Jason, I hear what you're saying, but I truly have experienced, forget Christmas chaos, year 2023 chaos. And that may be real. And if that's you today, I just want to read to you John 16:33. And it says, I have told you these things so that in me you may have peace. In this world, everything is going to be roses. In this world, everything is going to be a walk through the tulips and a day at the beach. No, in this world, you will have trouble. But don't stop there. In the midst of whatever Christmas chaos you may be truly experiencing, in the midst of whatever 2023 has brought your way, don't stop there. In this world, you will. Oh, God, here we go. You told me it was going to happen, and here it is. Don't stop there. And it says, But take heart. I have overcome the world. I have overcome the world. 1 Peter chapter 4, verse 12. Beloved, do not think it strange concerning the fiery trial which is to try you, as though some strange thing has happened to you. Count it all joy. Count it all joy. Life can get chaotic in the workplace, in school. Letdowns and tragedies that take place in your family. Life can get difficult. But I wonder if you can find yourself in that same place that the Shunammite woman found herself, standing over her child that was not breathing, and look to someone and say, it is well. And then traveling to go to see somebody to tell them about what was taking place. And then not only just saying it once, but saying it twice. Is everything well with your husband? Is everything well with your son? Is everything well with you? And look that person in the face and say, it is well. What was it about this Shunammite woman? Because she was going through some stuff. What was it about Joseph and Mary and that manger, that in the midst of murderous threats that had been carried out, in the midst of what would be perceived as a scandalous birth, in the midst of going from town to town to town, having no place to lay your head because of all the instability and Christmas chaos that was taking place. What was it about the Magi that said, I know that there is a murderous king that wants me to report back, but I'm not going back there. Instead of going back to that king, I'm going to the king, and I'm going to come bringing frankincense, gold, and myrrh, in spite of all that he's talking about. What is it about that manger? And I feel like on the inside of them, on the inside of Mary, on the inside of Joseph, on the inside of the Magi, on the inside of those shepherds, they knew in the midst of everything that is taking place, all the chaos and all the craziness and all the murdering and all the running and all the instability, if I could just get to that manger and behold this child that is born to us, I will know that I know that I know in that moment that the prophecy is right before me and fulfilled. Unto us in the town of David, a child will be born to you. He is the Messiah. This will be a sign to you. You will find him wrapped in swaddling cloths, lying in a manger. I believe that Mary, that Joseph, that the Magi and the shepherd, once they got to that place, just like the Shunammite woman ages before them, they were able to look and say, back in my town, they might be talking bad about me because I was pregnant, though I not lay with anybody. But it is well. I don't know. Joseph saying, I know my boys are going to be talking bad about me because I'm with a woman that's pregnant even though I didn't lay with her. And she's saying she didn't lay with anybody else. They're probably talking about me like a dog saying, I'm stupid, I should leave her. But now that I behold this child, and after everything I've been through, I'm beholding unto me a Savior is born. It Thank you. I'm not going back to that king because I know what he plans to do. In spite of all of that, I'm going to be disobedient to that king so that I can fall in obedient knee to the true king. In this moment, it is well. What is it? What is it about? What is it about the manger? You see, here's what I love. Here's what I love about those three words. The Shunammite woman, Joseph, Mary, the shepherd. This is what they understood that I want you to understand today, and I'm leaving. They didn't say, it's gonna be well. They didn't say, once I give it some time, and once I get to a certain place, it's gonna be well. In the midst of what they were going through, in the midst of maybe losing their job, in the midst of financial stress and hardship, in the midst of hard times, in the midst of losing friends, in the midst of sickness, in the midst of people talking bad about you, in the midst of everything they went through, they said, it is. I wonder if there's somebody here today that hasn't had a perfect life, and you've gone through some difficult things, you've gone through some struggles, you lost some friends because of Jesus, you lost a job maybe because of Jesus, people turned away from you, or maybe you went through a hardship, you lost a loved one, whatever is going on in your life, I wonder if you can find yourself like the Shunammite woman, like Mary, Joseph, the Magi, and the shepherd, and just get to that place where you stand before the king and say, it's not gonna be well. And here's what it is. Let me help you. Here's why it is well. Here's what the Shunammite woman understood. Here's what Joseph, Mary, the shepherd, and the Magi understood. That in that moment, according to the word, sin is already paid for. It's already. Not it's gonna be. For Mary, Joseph, the shepherd, and the Magi. Because this child was here, it was a prophecy fulfilled. It was a done deal. God is going to keep his promises. So on this side of the manger, on this side of the cross, we can say it is well, even stronger than they. Because it has already, come on, y'all. It has already. If Mary can say it, you can say it. If Joseph can, if the Shunammite woman can say it in the Old Testament, you can say it on this side of the cross. Sin has already been paid for. So it is, well, guess what? Heaven is currently our citizenship. This earth, somebody tell somebody, I'm just passing through. I'm just passing by. I am a citizen of heaven through Christ Jesus. And so come hell or literal high water, it is well, because my home is heaven. It is well. It is well because the devil is already defeated. God knows it. The devil knows it. Do you know it? The devil is already. So we can say it's not going to be well. It is well. It is well. And God is currently moving in your life. He's not waiting to move. He is currently moving in your life, in the hearts of your family, in the hearts of your children, in the hearts of your situation. If you would just stop fighting against the tides of what God wants to do and just lean back into his current of love and just say, it is. I wish I had 10 people that knew what I was talking about this morning, that would stand to their feet and give God a shout of praise. Not because you hope it is well, not because you think it is well, not because it's gonna be well, because it is well. Say it again. It is well. Say it again. Shout it out. Say it again. One more time, say. Now give the Lord a shout of praise in this place. Hey, hey, hey. with every head bowed and with every eye closed, you're here today and you hear me speaking and it sounds like I'm speaking your life. Man, I've been through this, I've been through that, I've been through the other, and it seems like things go from bad to worse. And I don't know what's going on, and I wish that I could say it is well. The reality is, without Jesus in your life, it is not well. I'm not gonna lie to you. You were just shouting it, and you felt weird. It didn't feel true. And the reality is, it's not well if Jesus is not your Lord and Savior. It's anything but well. You are one prayer away from walking in everything that God has done for you, and a Savior being born, and Him not staying a baby, but growing and living 33 years, teaching us how to walk, talk, act, think, react, pray, repent, and then dying on the cross so that your sins can be forgiven. Oh, you are just one prayer away from being able to truly say, it is well. If you're here today and you want to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, come on, this is the greatest gift known to mankind. If you're here today and you want to accept Jesus as your Lord and Savior, can you just lift your hand nice and high? You don't know that if you died today, if you would go to heaven. And you want to be sure. I'm telling you now, the only way is through Christ Jesus and the opportunity to say the sinner's prayer. Then and only then will your sins be forgiven you and the Holy Spirit come upon you and you walk in the righteousness He's calling you to walk in. If you're here today, lift your hand nice and high. Don't listen to the lies they tell you. Anybody gets to go to heaven, it's a lie from the pit of hell. Don't believe them. No man cometh unto the Father except by me. If you're here today and you want Him as your Savior, lift your hand nice and high. Nice and high. Hallelujah. I hear somebody clapping. I can't tell if a hand is up. Here's what we're going to do next. If your hand is up, oh, this is greater than anything you'll find under the tree. Come on, I want you to be able to say it is well with all your whole heart. If that was you and your hand is raised, can you come and just stand here at the altar? I just want to pray for you that we could see hell loose its grips on your life and that you would have Jesus as your Lord and Savior. Come on, come on, come on, come on. If you're coming, come on, if you know that you need to be coming too. You can't truly say it is well yet, but you want to be able to say it is well. Come on, there's room for you. 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 Come on. Come on. Come on. It is well. It is well. It is well. It is well. Come on if you're coming. Hallelujah. Those of you who are here, beautiful, 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 beautiful. Those of you who are here, just lift your hands like this. This just means I surrender, I surrender, I surrender. I'm going to stop trying to figure this thing out on my own. I don't know what tomorrow's going to bring, and I can't figure out yesterday. So I'm just going to let you do what only you can do. And I just want you to repeat after me. Especially those of you who are here in this altar, but we're all going to say it because we are all clinging to an all-sufficient Savior. Repeat after me. Say, Father, thank you for this opportunity to repent and be saved. Lord, I've done things that I know I shouldn't have done. And I also realize because of the sin in my life, I am disqualified from heaven. I'll never be good enough for heaven, but by your blood, I am qualified and I am cleansed. Lord, I believe that you suffered, that you died and were buried. And on the third day, you rose again, just like the Bible said you would. And you ascended into heaven. And you are seated at the right hand of the Father, and you're praying for me, and you have given me the gift of the Holy Spirit to lead me, to guide me, to correct me, to empower me to love me. I receive that gift. Fill me from the top of my head to the soles of my feet. Lord, today I am able to truly say, it is well. Lord, you are mine, and finally, I am yours. Come on, somebody give the Lord a shout of praise. This is our altar team behind you. They just want to pray for you and put a Bible in your hand. You can lead them out. Mary and Pastor Kirsten.